The nature of conscious experience remains one of the most profound and unresolved mysteries. The subjective feeling of reading these words, the awareness of the room around you, and the entire inner world of thoughts and feelings all point to a fundamental question. Is consciousness a rare accident that occurs only in complex biological structures? Or might it be a basic feature of the universe itself? This inquiry leads to what philosophers term the hard problem of consciousness, a puzzle that has prompted a revival of a radical and ancient idea. This radical idea is called panpsychism, the view that consciousness is a fundamental and widespread property of the physical world. It is crucial to distinguish this from the notion that simple things have complex thoughts. Panpsychism does not propose that electrons feel anxiety, or that rocks ponder their existence. Such sophisticated cognition is associated with complex structures like a brain. The theory instead proposes that the most basic constituents of reality possess a rudimentary form of experience, often termed proto-consciousness. This raw, elemental awareness can be compared to our own rich, self-aware mind in the same way a single pixel relates to a vibrant and detailed photograph. It is the simple, underlying substrate from which more complex forms of consciousness are constructed. While panpsychism is gaining new consideration within modern science, its core tenets are ancient. Today's theories represent a fascinating convergence point where cutting-edge scientific inquiry connects with the timeless wisdom of philosophical and mystical traditions. This video will explore the modern scientific case for this worldview, while tracing its surprising echoes throughout history. I'll also talk about the significant challenges the theory faces. Ultimately, the exploration will consider the profound, world-changing implications of a living cosmos that may not be an inert mechanism, but a dynamic and sentient reality. But before we begin, if you would like to support this channel so I can continue to make videos like this, there are links to donate via PayPal and Ko-fi in the description and pinned in the comments. I've been thinking about making a Patreon where I post extra videos for $5 per month, so let me know in the comments if that's something you'd be interested in and what you would like to see there. You can also click the join button here on YouTube to become a member for $5 a month. The easiest way to support the channel, though, is just to like, subscribe, and hit the notification bell so you don't miss the next video. Thank you so much for the support. Now let's begin. The modern scientific interest in panpsychism begins with a key philosophical insight. The philosopher Bertrand Russell observed that physics, for all its predictive power, is structurally limited. It describes the behavior of matter, its interactions, and its mathematical form, yet it remains silent about the intrinsic nature of matter itself. Physics illuminates the exterior properties of reality, but not its inner essence, leaving a fundamental gap in our understanding. Panpsychism seeks to address this gap by proposing that the inner nature of matter is consciousness or proto-consciousness. This attempt to ground consciousness in fundamental physics has historic precedent. As early as 1944, Erwin Schrödinger, one of the architects of quantum mechanics, grappled with similar questions in his seminal book, What is Life? He speculated that the remarkable order and unity of a living organism might arise from quantum coherence. He also famously proposed that the blueprint for life, the genetic code, must be stored in what he termed an aperiodic crystal. This was a structure capable of holding vast information, a prediction stunningly confirmed by the discovery of DNA. While Schrödinger was not proposing a theory of consciousness, his work was among the first to seriously suggest that the counterintuitive principles of the quantum world might be key to understanding the mystery of life. Building on this philosophical bedrock, A few key scientific theories have emerged that give panpsychism a modern, potentially testable form. One of the most prominent is the org-or theory from the Nobel laureate Sir Roger Penrose and Dr. Stuart Hameroff. Their work suggests that consciousness arises from quantum processes occurring inside microtubules, which are tiny structures within our brain's neurons. Although the theory is focused on the brain, its deeper implication is that the cosmos has the ingredients for awareness inherent in its quantum geometry. An even more influential framework may be integrated information theory, or IIT, developed by neuroscientist Giulio Tononi. IIT offers a mathematical definition of consciousness, proposing that any system possesses a degree of it based on its quantity of integrated information. A system's degree of consciousness is quantified by a value known as phi. For a system to possess a high phi value, it must contain a large amount of differentiated information that is simultaneously unified to an irreducible whole. This framework is not restricted to brains. According to IIT, any system with a non-zero phi value, including potentially a thermostat, an atom, or a proton, would possess a corresponding degree of experience. This provides a direct mathematical pathway to a version of panpsychism. Physicist Federico Faggin, inventor of the first microprocessor, takes this line of thinking further. Based on his study of physics and introspective work, Faggin proposes a model where consciousness precedes matter and is, in fact, the fundamental reality. In his view, the physical world, with its quantum and classical laws, is a symbolic system through which this primary consciousness operates and experiences itself. Matter, from this perspective, serves as a medium for consciousness rather than its source. These modern theories are transforming a historically philosophical idea into a subject of scientific investigation. Panpsychism is not without significant critics and faces major intellectual hurdles. The most serious challenge is known as the combination problem. The basic premise of this challenge is if fundamental particles possess a rudimentary form of experience, then how could these countless micro-experiences combine to create the single, rich, and unified consciousness of a human being? They contend that because no coherent mechanism for this binding has been proposed, the theory is left with a deep conceptual gap. However, in response to this very challenge, theorists are exploring novel scientific models that could provide the missing mechanism. The general resonance theory, for example, suggests that consciousness is not merely summed, but is the product of synchronized vibrations, much like tuning forks vibrating in unison. In this view, entities can share and combine into a larger conscious state by resonating together. An even more fundamental solution may lie in quantum entanglement. Within a quantum system, entangled particles behave as a single, unified whole regardless of their separation. This quantum holism offers a powerful framework by which individual proto-conscious entities could bind into a larger, irreducible conscious field, directly overcoming the classical criticism that they are just a mere collection of parts. Another common criticism is that panpsychism is unfalsifiable and therefore unscientific. The question of how one could ever prove or disprove that an electron possesses a primitive form of experience seems to place the theory beyond the reach of empirical testing. This objection may be premature, however, as modern frameworks like IIT offer a path forward. IIT makes specific, testable predictions. A system's measurable level of integrated information, its phi value, should correlate directly with its reported level of consciousness. This is a hypothesis that can be investigated in laboratory settings, for example, by studying brains as they transition between wakefulness, deep sleep, and anesthesia. If the mathematical predictions do not align with the empirical data, the theory would be disproven. A major scientific objection, particularly aimed at quantum models like Penrose's org-or theory, is that the brain is too warm, wet, and noisy to support the delicate quantum states required. Critics argue that any quantum coherence would be destroyed almost instantly by the thermal chaos of a biological cell, long before it can contribute to conscious thought. Proponents, however, point to the growing field of quantum biology, which shows that processes like photosynthesis and avian navigation successfully harness quantum effects in similar environments. Orc-or theory specifically proposes that microtubules within neurons may act as natural shields, using their unique structure to protect these quantum states. From this perspective, the brain is not a hostile environment for quantum mechanics, but a system that evolved to utilize it. Panpsychism must also contend with the mainstream scientific view of strong emergence. This is the idea that consciousness is a genuinely new property that appears once matter reaches a sufficient level of complexity, as it does in a brain. From this standpoint, consciousness does not exist in the constituent parts at all. It arises from their arrangement. While this may seem more intuitive to many scientists, panpsychism challenges it as a less parsimonious explanation. The emergence of subjective experience from components that have absolutely no experiential properties represents a profound explanatory challenge. As author Annika Harris has argued, this requires accepting that arranging non-experiential particles in a complex pattern can cause an entirely new property of inner feeling to spontaneously appear. From a panpsychist perspective, this leap from non-experience to experience is a greater conceptual miracle than the idea that complexity builds upon a simpler, pre-existing form of it. Long before modern science began to grapple with these ideas, cultures across the globe perceived the world as fundamentally alive. The most direct historical parallel is animism, the worldview of many indigenous peoples who recognize awareness and spirit in all things, animals, plants, rivers, and rocks. A similar perspective exists in Japanese Shintoism, which perceives kami, divine essences, in natural objects and forces. These traditions suggest that the intuition of a living world is one of humanity's most ancient. This concept of a conscious cosmos also flourished in the great philosophical traditions of the East. In the Advaita Vedanta school of Hinduism, one finds the concept of Brahman, the single universal consciousness that is the ground of all reality. The individual self, or Atman, is considered identical to this cosmic consciousness. The famous Sanskrit aphorism, Tat Dvam Asi, captures this idea perfectly, positing a complete identity between the individual and the universal. Likewise, in Taoism, the Tao is the natural, intelligent, and spontaneous ordering principle of the universe. It is the way that flows through everything, giving it pattern and nature. This intelligence is not anthropomorphic, but is instead conceived as an awareness immanent within nature itself. Remarkably similar ideas developed in the West. The ancient Stoics spoke of the Logos, a divine rational principle or cosmic mind that organized and permeated the entire universe, viewing the cosmos itself as a single, living, intelligent being. The later Neoplatonists described a universal divine mind called the Nous, which emanated from a higher source, the One, and contained the perfect forms of all things. In this view, all consciousness in the world flows from this cosmic mind. The Hermetic tradition stated it even more directly with their core principle, the All is Mind. They taught that the universe is a mental creation held within the mind of a universal consciousness. This connects to their other famous axiom, the principle of correspondence, as above, so below, which ensures this mental conscious nature pervades every level of reality. While these worldviews share an intuition of a living cosmos, important distinctions must be drawn. Panpsychism, which posits consciousness as a property of matter, differs from pantheism, which equates the universe with God, and from animism, which attributes individual spirits to objects. Of course, this view was not universal in the ancient world. The Sethian Gnostics, for instance, saw the material world as an evil prison, though they believed the Pleroma above and outside the material world was emanating from the One or the Invisible Spirit, which, similar to Taoism and the Platonists, is an unknowable, transcendent being that binds all other forms of existence. This contrast, however, makes the convergence of so many other traditions on the idea of a sentient cosmos all the more striking. They were all, in their own unique ways, pointing to a similar profound possibility. The concept of panpsychism reveals a remarkable convergence. On one side stands modern science, with its tools of objective measurement, third-person observation, and mathematics, which examines the world from the outside in. On the other side are the great mystical and contemplative traditions, which use introspection as a tool for the disciplined exploration of consciousness from the inside out. For centuries, these two paths of inquiry were seen as separate or even oppositional. Yet on the question of a sentient universe, they appear to be arriving at strikingly similar conclusions. We are witnessing a fascinating shift from metaphor to mathematics. The ancient sages expressed their insights through powerful allegories, poetry, and philosophical declarations. Concepts like the All is Mind or Tat Tvam Asi were profound spiritual statements. Modern theories are now attempting to articulate something very similar using the precise language of information theory and quantum mechanics. The Vedantic concept of Brahman as a universal non-dual consciousness finds a strange parallel in the mathematical framework of IIT, wherein any integrated system necessarily has its own unified experience. The ancient intuition is being equipped with a new and rigorous scientific vocabulary, suggesting that our deepest spiritual inclinations about the nature of reality might have a basis in the physical laws of the cosmos. If consciousness is a fundamental property of the universe, the consequences are enormous. They ripple outward, touching everything from human ethics to our technological future. Our relationship with the natural world would be reevaluated. Could living beings like plants be more conscious than we think? This worldview would demand a radical shift in environmental ethics, away from a position of dominance and toward one of oneness and respect. The implications for the future of artificial intelligence are equally stark. The debate over AI sentience would become much more consequential. A theory like IIT suggests that if a machine is built with sufficiently complex and integrated information processing, it will, by definition, be conscious. It will possess genuine subjective experience. This forces us to confront immense ethical questions about the rights of such a being. Could it suffer? Is it morally acceptable to create conscious entities merely to serve our own purposes? How would we feel if we started creating human clones to be our slaves? Should advanced AI be looked at any differently? Ultimately, this worldview alters our place in the cosmos. The prevailing scientific narrative has often cast humanity as an anomaly, a flicker of awareness in a vast, unfeeling universe. A panpsychist perspective tells a different story. It suggests that human consciousness is not a bizarre exception to the cosmic rule, but a magnificent and complex expression of it. We would be seen as a self-aware flowering of a universe that is fundamentally experiential at its core. This moves humanity from the role of lonely spectators of a dead cosmos to active participants in a living one. Thank you so much for watching. Let me know in the comments what you think of the theory of panpsychism. It's pretty controversial right now, but there are a lot of noteworthy and very smart people that support it. But as we all know, just because someone's smart in one area doesn't mean they know everything. As I mentioned in the beginning, if you would like to support the channel, there's a Ko-fi and PayPal link in the description and pinned in the comments. But the easiest way to support is just to like the video, subscribe, and hit the notification bell so you don't miss the next video. Let me know in the comments if you'd be interested in me starting a Patreon where I post extra videos and what you would like to see there. check out my website, oculus.com, and the other history channel I narrate for called Folks of Yore. Again, thank you so much for watching. Until next time.